Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Chris's Victor. Welcome to worship today. We're so glad to see you all. After our service today, we've got some extra music, so stick around and enjoy. And I think there's refreshments and stuff, too. This song is an old song by Daniel Boone. It's called Beautiful Sunday. Some of you might know it, and just you can sing along. Good morning and welcome to worship as we gather as the body of Christ called Christus Victor Lutheran Church. Yay! Hello. Good to see you all here today. We just have two announcements. One is welcome to Pastor Peter Helsted. He is preaching for us today. Yay, we get to hear a great message. Stefan was with him last night. Thank you so much for allowing us to perhaps extend our vacation a little bit. Vacation Bible School, Cheryl Helsted is over there at the VBS table. And if you haven't picked up your t-shirt or your download music card and you've registered, you can do that. And if you haven't registered and you want to do that, you can do that. And also, if you have any of the food donations, the snack list is also attached to the Sign Up Genius, so revisit it if you want to give to snacks, snacks and dinners. We have 1 week left, and then next Tuesday it all starts. It's going to be so exciting, and we have just as many kids registered as adults and teens, and so there's still time to register. Very excited for it to come, about God's monumental love.
Yeah, and I just have a quick plug for the next outdoor service, which is August 14th. So next month we're doing a Beatles service. So all the songs will be Beatles. So you'll want to come and, you know, sing all the Beatles songs. So that'll be next month at this time. Okay? So let's stand. We're going to pray and then sing our first song. Let's pray. Father God, Lord of justice and mercy, we come to you this day seeking your healing and reconciling love. Help us to be open to your word, your presence, your compassion. Clear our hearts of those things which block your will and peace of mind. Keep us focused on your enabling power so that we, having been healed, may more fully serve you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's sing our first song together, Because of Your Love.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another in the sign of peace.
I'd like to ask the kids to come forward here. I've got a couple of things I want to show you, and it's about our story today. It's a great story, but every story should have some pictures, I think. So I want you to help me tell the story. You can stand, you can sit down if you want. The pavement's kind of hard. You can sit in the grass. You can sit in the shade. You can come on up here. It's a story about somebody who helped a man. The man was in trouble, he was hurt, and there was nobody else around to help. But then this man came along. We call him the Samaritan. I don't know what his name was, but we call him the Samaritan. And then when he had helped this man who was hurt, he said, I can't just leave him here all by himself. I'm going to take him with me. And the Bible says he had his animal, and he put the man on his animal. But you know what? It doesn't say what kind of animal. So let's figure it out, okay? Let's look at some pictures here. I'll give you some choices, and you tell me if this is the animal you think it was. So Cheryl's going to show you the picture. This is a goat, and, you know, I'm thinking maybe he brought his goat with him, and maybe somehow the injured man could kind of lean on the goat or something as they walked along until they finally found a place where he could get cared for. Anybody think it was a goat? No? No votes for goat. Well, let's try another one. What's the next one here? Okay. What do you see here? Yeah, it's a horse. So maybe the man was riding a horse, and he put him on his horse to take him to see the doctor, take him to the hospital, take him somewhere where people would care for him. Do you think, how many think it was a horse? We got some votes for horse. Could be, although, you know, horse is about, what, this tall? Have you ever tried to lift a man that high and put him on a horse? I don't know. Well, let's see. There's one other choice I thought maybe. Let's show him that picture, Cheryl. Start over on this side now. So we're looking at a picture of a donkey. Oh, a donkey's not the same as a horse, is it? It's lower, that's right. And then this picture, the donkey has lots of big buckets strapped to his back. Those are buckets all full of water. That's heavy. Donkeys can carry a lot of weight. Anybody think it was a donkey? Oh, you all think it was a donkey. I think that's the best choice. And you know, sometimes it's fun when we hear the stories of the Bible to tell them again and say, I wonder what it looked like. I wonder what animals were there. So we're going to hear that story in just a little bit. I'll read it from the Bible for all of us, and we'll talk about it. I'm so glad you're here, but don't go anywhere because Pastor Melanie is going to share something very special with us.
All right. I have a very special lady who you may come up here, Rachel Miller. It's her last time as Sunday school coordinator today. And as you can all see, she's going to have another baby. So Rachel's gifts have been shared with us over this past year. Thank you so much, Rachel, for your welcoming, for your teaching, and for your interest in growing our Sunday school program from what we had at COVID online, and here we are. So give her a hand, everybody. Yay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Do you have any parting words? Do you want to say anything?
I just want to say it's been an honor to teach all of your children. They're all so wonderful. They have so many good thoughts to share at Sunday school. They make me smile and laugh every week. And it's just been so much fun. So thank you for sharing them with me.
All right, let's have a prayer. Lord God, thank you so much for your witnesses and your people that speak the faith to children and adults. Thank you for Rachel, for her sisters, for Laura and Diane, who were her team for this past year and who allowed us the ability to see you in powerful ways. Help her to have strength in her family as she has her third baby. And thank you so much for what you're doing in this place. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay, kids, you can go to Sunday school. Go ahead.
All right. Let us prepare our hearts for the reading of the word. Gracious God of glory, Prepare our hearts as we listen to your word. Open our hearts and minds and give us a desire to learn from you. May your Holy Spirit guide us into all truth and expand our understanding of your word in a real and living way. Bring nourishment for our souls and refreshment for our spirits as we hear your word this day. We pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
This is the reading, Colossians chapter 1, 1 through 14. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ in Colossae. Grace to you and peace from God our Father. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Jesus Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints. Because of the hope laid up for you in heaven, you have heard of this hope before in the word of the truth, the gospel that comes to you. Just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world, so it has been bearing fruit amongst yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This you learned from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love of the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard it, we have not ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him as you bear fruit in every good work as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience while joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sins. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is the Holy... Excuse me. This is the Holy Gospel according to Luke in the 10th chapter. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, what is written in the law? What do you read there? He answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said to him, you have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live. But, wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, a donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper and said, take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spent. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? He said, the one who showed him mercy. Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. So a man comes to Jesus and asks, what is the meaning of it all? What's the meaning of it all? What must I do to inherit eternal life? Somebody once went through all four Gospels and counted the number of times that a person asked Jesus a question. Because lots of people ask Jesus questions, of course. And I forget the exact total, but it was in the hundreds. It was several hundred times that people came to Jesus and asked him questions. Do you want to know how many times Jesus gave them a direct answer? You know, you think maybe 50%, something like that. Maybe every time. Maybe he just had an answer ready. Eight times. Only eight times did Jesus give an answer when somebody asked him a question, a direct answer. It seems as though that for Jesus, for the most part, he just didn't give answers. I suspect because answers were not usually what people needed the most. He was a lawyer, this man who comes to Jesus, not an attorney, but an expert in the field of religious law. You can tell that when Jesus heard the man's question, he wanted to do some soul work with this man. He had an opportunity here to engage him in conversation. He wanted to have him look deep inside, look into his own soul in a new way. So Jesus comes back to the man's question with a question of his own. What's in the Bible? What do you read there? Well, the man said, love God with all your heart, soul, strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. Very good, said Jesus. Do that, all that, and you will live. But the man had another question. And in this question, he revealed a little more of his own soul. He said, Jesus, who is my neighbor? Jesus, would you please define neighbor for me? Would you please make it clear? Who are the people who are neighbors, the people who God tells me I must love? And who are the people who are, shall we say, non-neighbors? I don't really have to worry about them very much, if at all. Please draw a line for me, would you? That's the catch, because he said, where do I draw the line between neighbor and non-neighbor? Please help me here, Jesus. So Jesus, in response, tells a story, as you know. A man go down the road from Jerusalem to Jericho. Robbers jump him, beat him up, leave him half dead. These are the bad guys, of course. Along comes a priest. However, when he sees the victim, he veers over to the other side of the road and passes him by. Next comes a Levite, another religious professional, and does the same thing. Those of us who are religious professionals, it gets a little close to home when we read this story. We have to try to think of, well, would I be one of those who handles all the religious things all the time, but I'm not so quick to practice my faith? Just a real good question for people like me. So these two passed by without offering assistance. No doubt they believed they had good reasons. I helped last time. Not my, it's somebody else's turn this time. I'm in a terrible hurry. I've got to get to Jericho. I know somebody's coming right behind me. The Levite is coming. He's good at this kind of thing. He'll take care of it. Oh, the robbers might still be hiding out. They might jump on top of me, beat me up too, and then we've got two victims here instead of one. I just better get out of here as quick as I can. So many excuses. I can't stand the sight of blood. The guy's a mess. I can't deal with this. So a man might very well be dying, the Bible says. He's half dead already, but excuses abound. A third traveler comes along, best part of the story. By contrast with the first two, he is a man of action. Let's take a close look at the text here. Look at the collection, if you would, at this moment in the story, the collection of verbs. I just want to walk you through this. Look what the verbs say that describe what the Samaritan does. He went to the injured man. He bandaged his wounds. Then he poured oil and wine on them. So, medication, oil to soften the wound, wine to disinfect. He put him on his own donkey. That probably was not easy. I remember the last time I tried to lift a human being, an adult human being, and not easy for me at least. Brought him to an inn, took care of him, and gave money worth 2 paydays, that's 2 denarii, gave that money to the innkeeper and said, spend it all if you have to. In fact, spend more, just put it on my account, do whatever it takes. The Samaritan. It's not just that he stops to help. He takes time. He makes a real effort. He goes out of his way. And having done all of that, he continues to care. To call someone a good Samaritan is high praise indeed. Where a lot of us might steer clear or be afraid that the situation is going to demand just too much of us, or we're really just not willing to leave our comfort zone, the Good Samaritan steps in to act. After telling the story, Jesus turns the lawyer's question around. This is how he does soul work, remember? He turns the lawyer's question around. The question is, Jesus says, which one of these three was neighbor to the man in need? The lawyer had asked, who is my neighbor? But that's always a limiting question, isn't it? Who is my neighbor? Who isn't my neighbor? Let me draw the line. It's a restrictive question. Who is my neighbor? But Jesus says, which one of these three was neighbor to the man in need? With Jesus, the question is about simply being a neighbor in any situation because there are no limits. There are no limits. So the man in the ditch is Jewish. The story presumes this. But the guy who stops to help is a Samaritan. Samaritans and Jews, you have to know, lived side by side in much tension, even hostility that went back centuries. We could do a 10-minute sidebar here on history of Jews and Samaritans. We're not going to do that this morning. But there was outright hostility. But it's a Samaritan who stops to help. They were not on friendly terms. So why did the Samaritan stop? The text says because he felt compassion. Actually, our translation reads, he took pity, but I kind of like the newer translations, and the Bible scholars tell us really the word here for compassion, it means you were moved in your gut. It's a deep feeling that moves you to action. We all know about compassion. We all know about compassion firsthand. So this week, this horrible shooting in Highland Park, is it way too close to home, I think, for all of us? And when I heard, it's hard to believe it was just this past week, just last Monday, but when I heard of the little 2-year-old whose parents were shot and he was wandering, didn't know what to do, and people found him, and of course, the good outcome is that he has been showered with love and there has been an outpouring of financial help for the family. But I've had a hard time handling that, I just have to say. And it's hard not to feel compassion in a moment like that. How can we not feel compassion? Compassion, says Jesus, is where being a neighbor starts. Starts with compassion. So if you're feeling compassion, stay with your compassion. Stay there. Don't just rush away from it. Don't just find something else to do. Don't just switch on something that will distract you. Stay with your compassion. Hang on to it. Come back to it as you need to, because it's about being a compassionate neighbor. So on the TV news Tuesday night, Cheryl and I were watching the news at 10 o'clock, and they were talking to people who were coming out of the Catholic Mass in Highland Park. Cardinal Supich, maybe you saw it in the news, Cardinal Supich went up to Highland Park Tuesday. They held Mass, and church was packed, of course. And the news crews interviewed people as they came out, and one woman was being interviewed, and she said, you know, so many beautiful words in there, and that helped. But we have to have more beautiful words, she said. What should we do? We need to do something. And that was her repeated question. Okay to have beautiful words, but what do we do? And Cheryl and I looked at each other and we said, well, what do we do? I mean, it's a really good question. March in the streets, have a candlelight vigil, call your congressperson. I there's all kinds of things. And each of us might be led to do different things. I think we also might be led to think, well, there's no use. You know, they've tried to work on this thing about mass gun violence, and it just, you know, there's just too much in the way. It's just not going to work. I think sometimes we give up too soon. We've already had enough prayer vigils, already had enough thoughts and prayers. That tends to be belittled. I get that, but you know, you never give up on prayer. You never do. You have to keep at it. You have to keep, wherever the compassion comes out, you stay with your compassion. You keep lifting up the people who are victims. You keep lifting up the world in need. As compassionate neighbors, what do we do? What do we do here at Christus Victor? Well, you know very well. We have the food pantry. We have the Thanksgiving dinner. We have MOPS. We have all kinds of things that reach out to our community. The PADS ministry, which has continued through the pandemic because we provide meals, will continue on as well. Christus Victor is always finding ways, because we are, as Pastor Melanie reminds us, we are the body of Christ. We'll always be finding new ways as we open ourselves to see the suffering in the world and keep asking, what can we do? How can we be neighbors? Especially in a time like this where there is so much suspicion and division and even hostility. It just won't be easy, will it? A personal story, if you'll permit me. I know you will. I have the microphone, but a personal story, because it goes back to when several years ago I had heart surgery. And I was a pastor over in Schaumburg, and this congregation, for one thing, supported me during that time. Pastor Melanie filled in for me for 4 months, so I didn't have to worry at all about the church. She just took care of it. And Deacon Patrick Briggs came to visit me in the hospital. Pastor Stefan was there for me. There were a number of people who did wonderful things to help us as a family through that time. I successfully recovered, thank the Lord. One thing happened that I will always for sure remember. The local rabbi in town called me up and he said, Peter, we'd like to bring over, there's a group at church that does this, we'd like to bring over food for your family some night. I thought, great, this is a nice surprise, but wonderful, thanks, we would love it. So we set the night, they came over, and what they brought was one of the biggest meals we've ever seen. It was this big tray of baked chicken with cherry sauce. I mean, that's not something people usually make, but they made that. Fortunately, this was January. It was real cold out, so we could store food in the garage, because there's no way to fit all of the food that they brought in our refrigerator. They had side dishes. They had salads. They had some wonderful dessert. I forget what that was. Just an outpouring of food. And, you know, we would have, I think, been delighted if they just come to the door and said, here's a casserole. We love casseroles. But they just outdid themselves. And I think about that, and afterwards I reflected that they could have said, you know, He's got his own church. He's a Lutheran. They'll take care of him. We'll care for our own. We'll just kind of let them worry about him and wish him well. I remember because at that time in town, we had an interfaith group, representatives from various religious groups that come together and share about their faith. And the question that would always come up for me as Lutheran pastor from the Jewish representatives was about, what about the anti-Semitic writings of Martin Luther? You talk about Martin Luther and his beautiful gospel teachings of the love of God, but how could he do this? And you know, they were very forthright about this. They didn't hold back, which I was glad that we could have that level of honesty in our relationship. And for that kind of question, there is no answer. We don't have Martin around to ask him. I say, Martin, could you just please get up and say it was totally wrong and apologize? We have apologized on his behalf. But there's no good answer for that. So for the Jewish people of town to come over with this wonderful meal, more than that we could eat off of it for several days because it was such a great meal, but it really lifted us up, lifted up our souls, that people would care about us in that way. Jesus wants to do some soul work in us. He is our good Samaritan. He comes to us. How ironic that he died on a cross between two robbers. So when we lie wounded or alone, he is the one who comes to pour mercy and love that will never fail. And he sets us free to be a neighbor. Amen.
One of the things we can do, if we're thinking about action, we can stand, we can worship, we can sing. Let's do the soul work now. Let's read and sing these words together, Lord, whose love and humble service, and see where that takes us.
Making known the needs and burdens, your compassion.
When I say God of grace, please respond with, hear our prayer. Show us your ways and teach us your path of justice and love. Raise up community and national leaders to challenge and dismantle societal structures that perpetuate ethnic, racial, and religious profiling and discrimination. God of grace, come near to all in need. Orchestrate kindness in the face of cruelty, hope where there is despair, love in the face of neglect, comfort where there is death, and healing in illness. Be especially with our refugee family as they settle into their new life in our country and our neighbors in Highland Park as they deal with the aftermath from the 4th of July parade shooting, and those we name silently or aloud. Lastly, we pray for the family of Big Ed and his family who are grieving his loss. God of grace, turn to this community toward the neighbors in need. Bring aid and support to those who are poor, beaten down, abused, forgotten, silenced, or avoided. God of grace. God of every time and place, in Jesus' name and filled with your Holy Spirit, we entrust these spoken prayers and those in our hearts into your holy keeping. God of grace.
Congregation, please be seated. So the question is, what can we do? Now it's time to share an offering. You might say, well, an offering is, we always do this on a weekend. It might not make a big difference, but in the eyes of God, God sees our heart. God sees our intention. God knows if our heart is filled with compassion. So let's share a compassionate offering, because God will multiply, God will bless, and God will bring healing. Thank you for sharing.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
Let us pray. God of abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let us now prepare our hearts for this holy meal. Lord God, on our mind is, our hearts and our minds are heavy because we are wondering what can we do in this world that is so messed up. But we do know that you came into this world and that you transformed this world, that you brought hope, that you brought healing, and that you go all the way. And we are grateful. We are grateful that we can be a church, we can be a community where we can experience your love and your encouragement and hope. And so, we can do something in this world. We can share your love compassionately with our brothers and sisters who are struggling. You sent us. We are the Good Samaritan, just like you, Jesus, are our Good Samaritan. You come and touch us. You come right now as you pick up this bread and you look at us and you know exactly what we need. And you take this bread and you break it and says, "This is my body that is given for you. I broke this body. I gave it for you so that you have life, abundant life." And then Jesus lifts up the chalice and says, "This is my blood that is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin." Whenever you drink this, whenever you taste this, you know that I'm real, that I'm a part of you, and that I have a plan to make this world heal, to make this world better. So we are gathering today as we are praying now the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. In Christ's presence there is fullness of joy. Come to the banquet. You are all invited to receive this holy meal. You can open now your cup. It is the body of Christ that is given for you, and the blood of Christ is shed for you. Do you have one? The body of Christ is given for you. I invite you to stand if you are able to receive God's blessing. We all need a blessing so that we can share peace. The God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you, comfort you, and show you the path of life this day and always. You are blessed. Amen.
Let's go out singing our final song, Build Your Kingdom Here.
Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts on.
in peace. Love your neighbor. Be a good Samaritan.
Be to God.